Bye. heard mine, I gotta go to another room. But it's good to have you all in today. For those of you that's first time here, we're so glad that you have taken time out of your day to come and be with us today to worship the Lord. We hope that something today is said, done, that would bring you closer to Jesus, and you'll have a great experience with him today. Amen?
Amen.
Thank you, Lord. Wow. Everybody having a good weekend so far?
Amen. Yeah.
Say it's a Sunday. No, it's
yes.
Come on, Mass. We're going to have a good time here today worshiping the Lord. How many of you got to see the yesterday, actually started Friday night, the return? Anybody? In Washington, D.C. yesterday, tens of thousands of Christians, they descended upon our capital, and they walked from the Lincoln Memorial all the way to, I believe they said the steps of the White House, and it was a prayer walk. Franklin Graham led them, but it was Jonathan Kahn, you know, if you've ever heard of him. But back in 2001, when the Twin Towers were hit, the Lord spoke to him and given him a word. He's been, ever since then, trying to warn America, especially, of judgment if we do not return to God.
Amen.
And yesterday, that's what it was all about. It was a return to God. One of the things that struck me, and I just wanted to share it with you today for just a minute here, was back when that happened in 2001, he said that our churches, people began to flock to the church, and churches filled up, and everybody thought, this is great, this is wonderful, and it was, but the problem with it was, that's all that happened. They just came back to the church and filled the church up. God is not calling for us. God is not calling for us to fill the church up.
Hallelujah.
He's calling us to repentance.
That's right.
Well, I got a few amens. But it doesn't change the truth.
Amen.
He said, if my people which are called by my name shall humble themselves and do what? Seek my faith and
turn.
That's a repent. That's a repentance. We turn from our wicked ways. And who was he talking to? If my people. He's talking about us. Those who call themselves Christians. Judgment. Man, I don't know why I'm on this. But judgment, he said, will begin in the house of God.
Yes.
If we can't get right, and if we can't, how can we expect the world to?
That's right.
Amen.
Generate. This morning, I pray that we, as they yesterday did, that we ask God, search our hearts, Lord. Lord, we cry out to you. We repent. And God, we pray for our land, but Lord, it's if I can say it this way, and I'm going to say it anyway, it's me today.
Amen.
It's me. We need to stop blaming everybody else. We need to stop blaming the world. The world is going to act like the world. That's who they are. But we are to be different. We who call ourselves people and children of God, we are to be different. Different how? We're to be the light in the darkness.
That's right.
This is not at all what I had intended. This is not at all where I had intended on going today, but it's good and it's the truth.
Amen.
Folks, we need to, as we come in today, we need to not just come in and seek the blessing of God, because that'll happen when we turn, when we repent. He'll bless. He said he would.
Yes, he did.
The scripture I just gave you said that he would. He said, if you'll do this, then will I hear from heaven and I will heal. Is that not a blessing?
Amen.
Amen. our part, I guarantee you, God will do his. Amen. God been good to you this week?
Amen.
Amen. Let's stand. We're going to sing another song and continue on into worship and sing about the goodness of God.
Of the good.
that just, and I thought back over my life, and there were times in my life, man, I didn't even want to be here anymore.
Mm-hmm.
That's how bad things gotten in my life. Even in those bad, dark times of my life,
yes.
I can look back, Harold, and see how good God was, even in those tough, bad times. How God was bringing me through, keeping me, sustaining me, and bringing me through it. And that's why I'm able to stand here today. Like, man, it was nothing. That was God's goodness.
Amen.
I should not even be here at all.
Yeah.
But God brought me through. Anybody else?
Amen.
Amen.
Say it again?
Many times.
How many times?
Many times.
How many times it came to now? That 41 years worth of it.
41 years?
41 years of it. In the prison and the streets with guns poured on me, throwing everything, and God had his hand on my back saying, come on, son, go this way.
Amen.
Yeah.
I started to go ahead and pray, and I said, wait a minute. This is what I'm going to tell you as we pray today. There are people who know how to pray. And when I say they know how to pray, they have all the eloquent words and all that. The Lord says, I just want you to pray from your heart. Just talk and tell me what it is. So that's what I want you to do today. And I may start to pray, but I want all of us to just pray out of your heart for this good Lord. Heavenly Father,
yes,
Lord, as we come to you right now, Lord, we're just so grateful, Lord, thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to lift up Thomas from before you. And Lord, Lord, I know today that there is absolutely nothing, Lord, impossible to those, Lord, your word says, who believe. And Lord, I believe today, Lord. I have seen, Lord, you do the miraculous, Lord. Lord, I've read, Lord, how out of your word, Lord, you heal those whom you touch, Lord. And Lord, I pray today, God, Lord, I'm crying out today, Lord, for your touch, that you can touch us, Thomas, here this morning, Lord. And Lord, I pray that God, Lord, you would do, Lord, the work, God, that needs to be done in Thomas, Lord. Not only in his body, Lord, but in his life. I pray, Lord, that this young boy, Lord, this little boy, Lord, would become a testimony, Lord, of the healing power, Lord, of not only his body, but, Lord, his mind. Lord, oh God, do God, as only you can. Thank you, Lord, for bringing him, Lord, into this church today, Lord. God, I look at him, and Lord, I know that there are others, Lord, that may look at him, Lord, outside, Lord, these four walls and think, poor little Thomas. Lord, I look at him today, Lord, and I smile, God, upon his face, Lord. Lord, I am myself today, Lord, just in this few moments, Lord, I have been touched, Lord, Lord, through what I have seen. And God, today, Lord, oh, wrap your arms, God, around him today, Lord. Lord, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, Lord. And we give you all the praise and all the glory, Lord, for it. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you,
Lord. Thank you, Lord. Wow. Can we just, as we go back, just give the Lord a good.
Thank you.
good morning to all those who are watching via our live stream this morning. Glad that you are watching as well. I want to read this to you. It says, I don't really understand myself or I want to do what is right, but I don't do it. Instead, I do what I hate. But if I know what I am doing is wrong, this shows that I agree that the law is good. So I'm not the one doing wrong. It is sin living in me that does it. And I know that nothing good lives in me, that is, in my sinful nature. I want to do what is right, but I can't. I want to do what is good, but I don't. I don't want to do what is wrong, but I do it anyway. But if I do what I don't want to do, I'm not really the one doing wrong, but it is sin that is living in me that does it. I read that and I thought, man, I found it. That God wrote a piece in the Bible just about me.
Amen.
Anybody else feel that way when you read that?
Yeah.
I read that, I'm like, wow. It's like looking in a mirror when you read something like that. I don't know this morning. In the last little bit, when I say little bit, week, month, several months, over the course of the season that we've been in here in 2020, do you feel like, especially in the last maybe week, month or so, feel like the attacks upon you and upon your family have intensified?
Amen. 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 Amen.
I have gotten several calls over the course of the last week or so from people who have asked me to pray for them because of attacks. And when I say attacks, I don't necessarily mean physical attacks, but spiritual attacks.
Yes.
I've noticed that because they are beginning, or it seems like they are increasing, not only with you or those who know us, but also even in my own life. And I don't know, just a few weeks ago, I preached the message, I may be weak, but I'm still anointed.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
And I know that over the course of the last few months, again, the season that we've been in, this 2020 pandemic, can't do this, can't do that, and all kind of things, being in your homes. I know that this past week the governor lifted the thing with the restaurants and the mask mandate, all that kind of stuff. But still, even that up until then, it's. And I've told you that it seems like we've been in our homes, we've been with one another, and separated as far as church. We just recently have been able to come back together as a church. We were online and we did that, and that's great. But I'm going to tell you, and I'll say it again. It's good, and I'm glad that we have the live stream, but if I can use good old Southern vernacular, it ain't like being here.
That's right.
That's right.
It's just not. It's just not like being here together praying with one another, praying with one another, praying for one another. It's just not the same. Able to come back together, but while we were apart, many of you said to me, and as well, we became very vulnerable. We became very vulnerable. We became, and I'll say it this way, and got my hand up, me too. We became weak.
Yes.
And the enemy knew that. And that's what his plan was and is. Separated from one another. The strength, we draw strength from one another when we're together. So if he can keep us separated and vulnerable, he knows that man, half his battle is just about won. But I'm glad that we're back together. And we are, man, last week was off the chain.
Yes.
It was just an awesome service. And today, I just feel like God is up to something even here this morning. You're not here, you have not come here just by chance, but God has had a plan all along.
Amen.
And while we, over the course of the last few weeks, months, we have become weak, vulnerable. He is strong.
Yes, he is.
We learned a few weeks ago that when we are weak, that's when he is very strong in our lives. We need to recognize that. Even though we're weak, we're anointed.
Amen.
We're called of God. Yeah. But even though we're called of God, sometimes in that state of vulnerability, I have found, again, even myself, like the little scripture that we read there at the very beginning, the things that I want to do, I don't do them.
Amen.
And the things that I don't want to do, that's the very thing, Mike, I end up doing. Why is that? Because I'm weak. And the enemy knows that if he can keep us in that state of vulnerability, that we'll just keep doing that over and over and over again. And he'll wear us down. I know, now this, and let me say it this way, he'll keep us in a place where we're weak, and when we're weak, what do we begin doing? We begin falling prey to his temptation, and things that he'll bring, and we'll find ourselves falling back into those things that God has set us free from. Did I just lose my lunch here? Okay. Because I know, again, from my own experience, when I'm weak, I tend to, I fall back into old habits. And I know, not to point fingers, I just know that there are some of us sitting here today that because of this extended season and us being vulnerable and weak, somehow you have fallen. Oh, you haven't told me. I haven't seen you, but there's one that has, and that's why he's laid this message on my heart today, is because he wants you to know. He knows.
That's right.
You're weak and you're in a state, you're in a vulnerable state, and if you're not careful, you'll fall right back in those same old habits that he sets you free from. What do you mean? What do you mean, Pastor? I know for myself, you all know my story. Temptation doesn't start out with this big old thing. This is what I want you to do, and I mean, it's obvious that I ain't doing it. It'll start out with something small. Like for me, I've been raised in church all my life, but when I turned 18, I left home. So I live where you want me to live all my life. I live where I want to live. I know everything now. I'm 18, for goodness sake. And I remember my mom, and you all know too what she said to me, but there's something else that she said that I don't think I've ever told you. She told me, because she knew where I was going. See, my brother, he played bass in the band. My brother's the one that got me the job as the drummer. And she knew what he was doing, and I had never been exposed to anything. She says, listen, if you're going to go, don't get into that drinking scene. And I told her, I said, never have. I don't have any desire to do any of that. I just won't play drums. That's all I'm going to do. But I remember my brother was very influential in my life. And I remember brother, one night we played in front of I'm going somewhere, just stay with me for just a minute. My brother, we played in front of this officers club, all these military. And I was expecting maybe 50. I never played in front of a crowd before. And there was over 5,000 people showed up.
Wow.
And I was a good drummer, but I'd never played in front of that many people before. And I got up there, I couldn't play. I froze up.
Oh, no.
My brother said, what's wrong with you? I went, I don't know. I just, I'm like, I'm so nervous. He said, come here, we'll fix that. I remember being off the stage, and he had this look like one of those solo cups with Pepsi in it. He said, drink that. I said, what is it? He said, just drink it. And I drank it, and when I drank it, I knew that wasn't Pepsi. Because it burned all the way down. And I found out later that he had mixed some Pepsi with 151 something, had all these numbers on it. I don't know. Wild Turkey was another. But anyway, long story short, I played like nobody's business that night.
Wow.
They said that was the best I'd ever played in my life. They said. I can remember from that point on, give me another one of those.
Mm-hmm.
And I would drink.
Yeah.
And I would drink.
That's the
and I would drink. After I told my mom, I'm not going to get into that.
Yeah.
And there I was. Long story short, you all know, I turned into an alcoholic. Everybody said I had a problem. It ain't no problem. I mean, anytime I want to, I just do it so I can play.
Yeah.
Let me tell somebody something here.
Uh-huh.
If more than two or three people tell you something's wrong,
sometimes.
Hello, McFly.
Something
wrong. If more than two or three people tell you that something's wrong.
Amen.
And people kept telling me, man, there's something wrong. No, I'm good. I never will forget my 18th birthday. My 18th birthday, I was playing in a club, and I already had, every time that I went to play, I drank at least a fifth of vodka before I ever get on the platform. And I was already pretty well gone. When everybody there who knew me said, it's your 18th birthday, I'm going to buy you a drink. And they did. And in 15 minutes, I drank every drink that everybody bought me. I remember walking back to the stage, and I remember sitting down on the drum stool, and all of a sudden I thought, I can't feel my legs. And you ever hear somebody say that you caught a buzz? My entire body began to vibrate. Until they said I just fell off a dumpster in the floor. He took me home, and that night I died 3 times. I stopped, absolutely stopped breathing. I had alcohol poisoning. I had a problem.
Yeah.
I had a problem. And I didn't want to admit to it, but I knew where the answer was too.
Mm-hmm.
Because I had grown up in church, my mom, dad, pastors, and I went home. And out of pride, saying I don't need them as or God as much as I just want to see my mom and dad. But I knew I needed God. I knew they knew where he was at. And I went home. That night that the church got candy and went there, and you'll know I got saved, and the Lord delivered me of alcoholism. And that's, I'm not talking about a 12-step, I'm not talking about a 2-step. I mean, God absolutely delivered me that night.
Amen.
But I got to tell you, there are times, not when I want to, but there are times when I think back to that. And I know that if I'm not careful, I'm never above temptation.
Come on.
Listen to me. You are never above temptation.
Amen.
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 But I say that because there are some of you that are sitting here today, and because of, see, when I start to go through some bad periods or times in my life, I think back to those things.
Amen.
The enemy will bring that back up. And you remember back when you had such a bad time, and man, you had that drink, and you did this, and did, and man, everybody was laughing, everybody had a good time.
Yeah.
And you see how, that's how it works. And not just with alcohol. I know that's what it was with me, alcohol and drugs. But you know, there are other things that some maybe sitting right here today have difficulty with, things like you just can't stop clicking that Amazon button and spending all that money. I know we laugh at that, but some people, they have a real problem with that.
Yeah, amen.
Spending. Or there are those who my cousin, I love him, and he is a Christian, but he tells me all the time that about going to, I can't remember the name of it, it's a casino, and he'll go there, and he gets himself in trouble as far as spending, gambling, and not just him, but those who think that, man, I'm just one more time, just one more time. I know I lost this time, but man, I'm about to hit it big next time. And the enemy has you convinced that it's going to happen.
Yeah.
And you fall prey to that because you're weak, you're vulnerable. Not just gambling, but there are other things like lying. You tell one lie, and you think, man, that's it. But now you got to tell another one to cover that one up. And before, man, you've told so many lies, you don't even know what the truth is anymore.
Amen.
That's right.
Wow. Social media. Facebook. Yeah, I read that post. Hold on, Pastor. I'm about to give these people a piece of money. You don't have a piece left to give anybody. Put it down. And you know, I'm doing that about Facebook. Our phones, we don't even talk to each other anymore. I'll text you. And you're sitting in the next room.
Or in the same room.
Yeah, you're right. You do it. One of these days, your thumb's going to just fly off. There's so many things that we God has set us free from, but we find ourselves going back to, and we can't seem to overcome. Like the scripture I read, the things I want to do, I don't do. The things I don't do, it's the very thing that I do. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13. And I want to use this as a central...
Oh, sorry. I'm on it.
1 Corinthians 10, 13. She'll put it up there.
Yeah.
It says, so if you think you're standing firm, there hath no temptation taken you but such as common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that you are able, But will with the temptation also make a way to escape that you may be able to bear it. Reading from a little different translation here, it reads this way. So if you think you're standing firm, be careful that you don't fall. No temptation has overtaken you except that is common to mankind. And God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you are tempted, he will also provide a way out so that you can endure. I want to tell you this morning that with every temptation, it doesn't matter what name you want to put on it. With every temptation, and this should be some, every temptation, there is a way out.
Amen.
I'm living proof of that. There is a way out. With every temptation, there is always a way out. What is temptation? Temptation is anything that promises satisfaction at the cost of obedience to God.
Amen. That's
right. All right. I want to say it again. Amen. Temptation is anything that promises satisfaction at the cost of obedience to God. Temptation. What is it? Well, scientists have proven, and they say this is what happens whenever temptation comes. There's a little thing in your brain that whenever temptation comes and you give into that temptation, dopamine is released into your brain, and it's like getting that hit off of that marijuana. Anybody know what I'm talking about?
Come on.
How do you know that?
I'm just teasing with you.
But it's like that. It's like those who drug addicts, alcoholics.
Yeah.
Who whenever I take and would take, there it is. It's like. Getting that hit, it gives you the thrill for the moment.
Yes.
Gives you that up and excitement. Mm-hmm. Okay, that's what it. And then this is what happens after that. All of a sudden, there's a letdown. There's a letdown. There's not only a letdown, but then all of a sudden, shame and guilt come along. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 15. It says, says, for we have not a high priest which cannot be touched with the feelings of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. He was tempted, but he didn't sin. What's that mean? Sometimes, and I've told you, and I'll tell you again, that sometimes God just has to explain things to me in a very simple way so that I understand it. And this is the way that he did it. Anybody still like donuts?
Oh!
I sure do. I'll tell you the ones I like. And man, I love those round with the chocolate frosting on the top.
Oh,
I love those things. And I cannot pass a Krispy Kreme when the hot sign on. That's a near impossibility. But listen to me. This is the way the Lord explained it to me. That it's not a sin to be tempted. Somebody can bring those donuts in and know that I love donuts, and I'll walk up and see those donuts, and I'll slow down and look at those donuts, and like,
oh no,
Krispy Kreme. I was tempted, but I kept going.
Uh-huh.
Amen. Now, if I stop, and I pick one up, and I begin to look at it, and I begin to turn it around, that's how it works. And he makes us then think that we're hopeless. Nothing. We feel trapped. We'll never be able to get beyond this. Someone one time tell me that it's actually a pastor that told the story of he was at home and he got a call from someone that went to the church and he was a traveling salesman. He said, "Pastor, I just need to call you and talk to you." He said, I'm out on the road, and he said, "I was here in a motel room, and Pastor," he said, I want to watch TV, and I turned the TV on, and I began to look at what shows were available, and he said, I got to the movies, and he said, before I knew it, he said, I was at the bad movies, and Pastor, the pastor said, "Did you watch them?" He goes, "No, I didn't watch them." He said, "You're telling me that you are out on the road by yourself, you're in a motel room, and you got the remote in your hand, and you were going through the movies, you got to the bad movies, and you didn't even watch it?" He said, "But Pastor, I feel such guilt, and I feel such shame. I didn't watch any of it." He said, "And I feel so hopeless. I feel like a complete failure." Pastor said, "Listen to me. Rather than look at that as a complete failure, I look at it as a narrow victory."
Yeah.
Yeah.
"You didn't watch it. Tell me the truth." He said, No, I didn't watch it." He said, "No, you were tempted. You didn't give in to the temptation." I look at that as a narrow victory.
Amen.
But still, it was a victory. See, the enemy wants us to feel guilty and shame. It doesn't, listen to me. By no means does it mean and give us the go-ahead to hang around temptation. Oh, y'all didn't get that, did you? Let me say it again. I don't think you heard me. Don't go hanging around temptation. In other words, whenever you're walking past the Krispy Kreme donuts and you made it past, don't go get to your office. You know what? I need to take one more look. How many? Yeah. Don't hang around temptation. Don't hang around where you know that you're weak. Don't. Y'all are being real quiet right now.
This is good.
Don't hang around where the temptation is. Because if you're not careful, you might just pick one of them up.
Amen.
Huh?
Amen.
So, number one, it's not a sin. Number two, you're never above temptation. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse number 12. Just before that scripture there, or I'm sorry, back in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 12. You got it?
Got it.
Here we go. "Wherefore let him..." Oh, boy. "Wherefore let him that thinketh he standeth take heed lest he fall."
Right.
Wow. Give me a minute. Lord, you're going to have to help me here. In other words, those of you that are sitting here this morning, and you are thinking right now, inside of you thinking, "I never do that." Now, this message is for you today. I would never, ever do that. I will never, ever. Listen, "Wherefore let him that thinketh he stand, take heed, lest he fall." Satan will attack you at your weaknesses.
Oh, yeah.
family man. Their family meant everything to them. They did everything with their family. And yet, they failed. I know some. And the very thing that they said that they'd never do, that's exactly what ended up happening. I'll never do that. Take heed. You need to guard yourself against self-confidence. Guard yourself against self-confidence. I think of so many of those who are in positions. Doctors who they're called upon to help people, but yet they abuse that calling by writing prescriptions for people that's not even patients. I'll never do that, and yet there they are. We need to, first of all, know that sin is not a sin to be tempted. Second, you're never above temptation. And then thirdly, God will never tempt you. I said, God will never tempt you.
So many say that he has.
I need to say it again. God will never tempt you.
He will never.
Well then, Pastor, what in the world is this happening with me? I'm glad you asked. Because I'm going to say it again. God will never tempt you. God will test you. And in thinking about a test, I don't know how many of you remember your school days, but in school days, whenever the teacher gave a test, why did she give us a test? To see how you wants to know where you're at, and to
know what you learned,
and to promote you. If you are in a at the end of your school year, they give you final exams.
Yep.
Why do they give you final exams? So that you can be promoted to the next grade,
Amen.
To the next level. So God tests us in order.
Ooh, hallelujah.
God tests us in order to push us forward.
Yes. Yes,
yes. In order to promote us. However, the devil tempts us in order to pull us back. You're being pulled back. That's the temptation trying to pull you back into the things that he has set you free from. When God tests you, he tests you in order to promote you, in order to push you forward. Amen?
Amen.
Wow. God will never tempt you. You got some scripture for that, Pastor? Absolutely. In James chapter 1, verse number 13, this is what it says. Let no man say when he is tempted that I am tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man.
Amen.
Let me read that in a little bit updated version of where you can understand it. And remember, when you're being tempted, do not say God is tempting me. God is never tempted to do wrong, and he never tempts anyone else. Temptation, where's it come from then? Verse 14. Where's it come from? But every man is tempted when he's drawn away of his own lust.
Amen.
And enticed. Temptation comes from our own desires, which entice us and drag us away. Verse 15. And when we're dragged away, when lust has conceived, it brings forth sin, and sin, when it's finished, brings forth death.
Amen.
The desires, they give birth to sinful actions, and when sin's allowed to grow, what does it do? It gives birth to death. Wow. That's exactly what was happening to me with the alcohol, the drugs. Coming home, I knew I was dying. Doctors had already told me, if you don't quit, you're going to die. But we're afraid at this point in your life, if you do quit, the withdrawals might kill you. And I'm so thankful that I can stand here as a testimony only unto Him, that when He delivered me that night, He completely delivered me of all of it, and I didn't go through not one withdrawal. Not one. Not one. That's how good God has been to me. Martin Luther said this one time. A real theologian, in order to be a real theologian, you need three things. Prayer, meditation, and temptation. What? One of them sound like they don't fit. You need three things, he said. You need prayer, meditation, and temptation. Prayer, talking to God. Meditation, hearing from God. And temptation, depending on God.
Amen.
Amen.
Wow. Because listen, you got your pens and paper out. You might want to write this down. This is one of those refrigerator moments with the magnet and put it on there. You ready? Every temptation is an invitation to depend on Christ.
Wow.
That's powerful. Every temptation is an invitation to depend on Christ. Wow. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. It's not a sin to be tempted. You're never above temptation. God will never tempt you. Every temptation is an invitation to depend on Christ. And this is what I came here to tell somebody today, that it doesn't matter how much it feels like you are trapped and there's no way out, it's hopeless, this is the way I've always been, this is the way it's always going to be, there's no hope for me, this is just my life, I mean, it's always been this way, I'm never ever going to be free.
No.
Are you listening?
Amen.
There is a way out.
Amen.
There is a way out. He promised that there was a way out, and there will always be a way out. Back up in verse number 13, go there. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13. Listen to what it says. There hath no temptation. Put whatever name you want to on it. There is no temptation that has taken you, but such as common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that you are able, but will. Say that with me. But will, with the temptation, also make a way out.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
He'll make a way out. He'll make a way out.
Yes, He will.
With every temptation, He will make a way out. What's my way out, Pastor? What do I need to do? Well, it may be different with you. It may not be the same as it was with me. It may be confessing it to Him, telling Him that you need His help. Confession. He said, His word says, if we confess our sins, that He's faithful and He's just to forgive us of that sin and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Thank you, Lord.
That's His word.
Thank you, Lord.
So confession may be a way. Repentance is certainly a way. Lord, I repent. We talked about it earlier. Repenting, what is that? That's turning 180 degrees from the direction to go a completely different direction.
Amen.
Repentance.
Yeah.
By the way, repentance is not the same. You know, there are a lot of people that come in here and the Holy Spirit. Spirit will begin to move upon them, and they know that they need to make a change in their life. And they'll sit here sometimes in these seats, and they will, tears will flow down their faces. But yet, they'll get up out of the seat, and they'll leave just like they came in. Why? Because they didn't repent. Oh, they were sorry. I'm sorry. Godly sorrow is not the same as repentance. Just because you had a good cry doesn't make it go away. The only thing that will make it go away is that whenever you may cry, you may not. But the only thing that will make it go away is for you to confess that sin to Him and to turn it over to Him and let Him cleanse you and take it from you. That's the only way.
Yeah.
Yeah. with my imagination again. Instead of and cussing at the screen and get out of my way and getting mad, hyper grace. Us a way out.
Amen.
Oh, I'm so thankful that God, those many years ago, might gave me a way out. When I felt trapped, I'm never going to be free from this. I might as well get used to it. And I said, no, come on, hit the button, boy. Hit the button. Hyper grace. At that camp meeting, and I pressed the button, and God's grace came into my life, and He delivered me.
Yes!
He delivered me. He can deliver you as well.
Amen.
I said He can deliver you as well.
Amen.
Amen.
Wow. God is good.
All
is good. Christ in me is more powerful than the sin and temptation around me.
Amen.
Christ in you is more powerful than the sin and temptation that surrounds you. Every temptation is an invitation this morning to depend on Christ.
Yes.
God will always. Who said that? Say it again. Say it again. Come on, say it for me. God will always. Always.
Loud.
God will always give us a way of escape. A way out. A way out. But listen, when God gives it to you, you got to take it.
Yeah. You won't force it on.
You got to take it. You can't play around with it. You can't say, "What? Hold on, God. Just one more peek at those things that you shouldn't be looking at." Hold on, God. Just one more toke. One more hit.
No.
Hold on, God. Just one more. One more sip for old time's sake. See, that's what the enemy wants you to do. Just one more.
That's right.
He says, hit the button. Come on, hit the button. And He's cheering for you. You hear me? I said, He's cheering. Presence, Lord, we say so many times around here, and we know it's true, that Lord, not come into your presence, God, and not be changed. But Lord, I pray today, God, that every person that is here today, Lord, and even those who are watching us via live stream, I pray today that God, that every person has sensed your presence in this place today. And God, now I know that you have spoken to us, and Lord, your word is telling us today that God, you understand and you know exactly where we are. And that God, you're telling us today that Lord, every temptation, Lord, it's an invitation to depend on you. And that, Lord, with every temptation, you will provide and have provided a way out. I pray today that, God, for those who are here and those, again, that are watching and listening, Lord, I pray today, God, that, Lord, we would hear. Lord, not me and not my words, not my voice, but God, I pray today that, Lord, we would hear, Lord, you tell us today, Lord, that you have provided a way out, and that, Lord, that would give us hope, that, Lord, we, the enemy has told us for so long, this is the way we are, this is the way we've been made, and there's no hope for us, you might as well get used to it. Lord, help us today, God, to have hope that, Lord, you have provided a way out. And you are that way. Help us, Lord, to depend upon you. That, Lord, even though that, Lord, you provided a way out, and God, we may have taken the way out, Lord, that doesn't mean that we are now above the temptation to sin. But, Lord, that we may even be tempted, Lord, even more. And that, God, that as we walk, Lord, with you, Lord, we may trip up, but Lord, help us to remember, Lord, that we may find ourselves in that spot where it looks like we're trapped, no way out. Help us to remember hyper grace. Hit the button. Call on the Lord. That, Lord, you may provide a way of escape, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We ask it today in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Now, while you're still standing there, still praying, I just want to ask this today. Is there someone here today that you would say, Pastor, I've heard this word, and man, you've been talking to me, and I need help. I need his help to get through this season. My hands are up. I'll put both. If I could get my feet up right now and still stand up, that's me. I need his help. Anybody else need his help?
Every day.
Okay. Those of you that got your hands up, keep them up for a minute. Here's what I want you to do. Everybody look around for those that have their hands up. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to get with somebody. Get with somebody. Lay your hands on them. We're going to pray today. We're going to pray for one another. Come on. Let's do this. Let's pray for God's strength and help. First of all, I want all of you to know this. You're not in this by yourself.
Amen.
I said you're not in this by yourself. You're not alone. All of us is going through something. All of us need his help. Okay? But we're all in this together. We're all praying for one another. Helping one another. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we lift up every person today, God, that is here that has said, Lord, they need your help. Lord, again, every temptation is an invitation to depend upon you. God, I pray, Lord, today, depend on ourselves and be self-confident that we will never do that. We'll never fall back into that. Help us to realize, God, that we're not above temptation. But Lord, help us, Lord, to right now fall upon the grace of God, that Lord, you may help us and you may provide a way out. Give us that we need to walk daily. Help us to realize that right now, God, we're not in this alone. We're not in this by ourselves. But Lord, we have one another. God, most of all, we have you. Thank you, Father. Lord, I pray that, God, you would give each person here today, Lord, extraordinary, supernatural strength. Lord, you've already given us hyper grace. And we thank you, Lord, for that. Lord, give us the strength that, God, we need to walk every day in such a way that it would bring honor and glory to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.